James. James Arnold Taylor.
Of fantastic shows and events going on right here at Disney's Hollywood Studios. So we have got some fantastic stuff that's about to happen, but other things that are going to happen throughout the night. I hope you come back and see the fireworks tonight. Anybody? Symphony in the Stars? Have you seen it yet? Oh, it is the best display of fireworks you'll ever see, set to the most beautiful music in the world. John Williams, Star Wars themes, fantastic stuff. I hope you check it out. My name is James Arnold Taylor. I am a voice actor by trade, so that means I spend my time in little padded rooms talking to myself most of the time, you see. But they let me out to host this event, and so some of you may say, well, I don't recognize you here, but where would I recognize you from? And I say, well, I'm a voice actor, so you might recognize my voice. And that's the question I always get. I'm in Jedi's.
A Johnny.
And a Jack.
That's Captain Jack Sparrow.
A mouse. A dog. And a cat.
I've been a caveman.
A leader. A mini me too. On Guardians of the Galaxy.
I'm Cosmo.
And Nandu.
For video games, I'm Ratchet, it's true. But now it's a movie coming to theaters near you. I'm Tidus, Spider-Man, Silver Surfer.
Magneto.
Gigi, Prince Joe.
And Cowabunga, there's Leo.
And a Transformer too.
I voice them in games.
They're great fun to do.
But sometimes celebrities can't provide their voice, so I step in and give them a chance, like Christopher Lloyd,
or Jay Baruchel,
Andre the Giant,
or Chris Walken,
Cowbell,
yeah, Walt.
But wait, there's more, like that stuff that you hear at the end of the show when the credits are near.
It's Sunday Funday, 7:30, 6:30 Central on Fox.
In closing, I'm also that voice that comes on that speaks very fast for C's hair, then he's gone. Offer expires on number 30, C store for details, batteries on the key, that's true, so use only is to read. Yes, it's all a part of the crazy VO that makes up the life of a voiceover Joe. Thank you. So you see, that's how I spend my time day to day, and I love it. I think voice acting is the best job in the world, and I hope you come back here at 7 o'clock tonight, Theater of the Stars, for my show, Obi-Wan and Beyond. It's a lot of fun. I'm going to take you through my life as a voice actor, do about 200 different voices, and hopefully inspire you and let you have a good time before you go to those fireworks. But now, the fireworks are here on the Stars of the Saga talk show. We have fantastic guests. We have Jedis. We have Ewoks. And we have these people that wanted to say hello as well. Take a look at the screen.
We can't be there with you, but we wish we could.
And have a great time, and hopefully next time in Star Wars Weekend.
And may the force be with you.
Indeed.
Thank you. Yeah, they're working on something, huh? Are we excited about what they're working on, or are we... Now you've come alive. Yes. Oh, I am excited about our guests. And before I bring out our first, he is such a talented actor of television and film. And again, multiple roles, a Jedi, but also a pretty bad guy. Let's take a look at him on the screen here. Check this out.
Captain, look!
The Sith have been extinct for a millennium.
This isn't how it's supposed to be.
Your thoughts dwell on your mother.
Ladies and gentlemen, Silas Carson! Have a seat. Look at this.
Wow.
Silas, isn't this great? Look at everybody.
It's warm out here.
It is warm.
It's very cool back there.
And
Hello.
How are you? You guys doing good? Excited to see him? Man, this is... Now, how many Star Wars weekends have you been to? Do you know how many exactly you've come to of this event?
This is my third.
Third one? Okay.
I was here for the first time four years ago. The
yes.
First time, I think, was about 9 years ago.
Wow, okay. Yeah, because we had a great
time.
When
you were so big.
Yeah. We had a great time last time, though, and now here we are in the Theater of the Stars. We've got Warwick Davis, which you know, you'll have to contend with here in a
bit. The one and only Warwick.
Yes, that's right. But you have been multiple people, multiple characters, I guess they're not people necessarily, in the world of Star Wars.
Yes.
How does that happen for an actor? Yeah, what happens? You get a call from George Lucas, a casting person. How did it all come about?
It was very weird how the whole thing unfolded, actually. George was auditioning people for the role of a pilot, which
okay.
never actually made the screen. There was a character who had a few scenes. And I went along and met Robin Gerland, who was George's kind of PA and casting director, for this character. And then they called back in about a week and said, sorry, we've written him out, but we'd like to see him for another little role, the tiny role that you see me playing, Lieutenant Williams.
Okay.
So I went back and met them again, and whilst I was there, Robin said, do you want to go and have a look at the art department?
Sure.
You know, this was in Leavesden Studios where they filmed the very first one, Phantom Menace.
Okay.
And I said, yeah, I'd love to have a look around. So they took me to where they do all the prosthetics, and there was this beautiful head, which was the head of Keanu Reeves. Somebody was sculpting him out of clay. And I looked and I was like, wow, that's just an amazing piece of work.
Right.
What is this going to be? And they said, oh, he's going to be a Jedi Master. And I said, who's playing him?
Yeah.
And they went, well, we don't have anybody.
Really?
At the moment, we haven't got that far. We haven't, you know, gotten to the casting bit. And he looked at me and said, have you ever done prosthetics before? And I said, no, I've never done prosthetics. I'd love to be able to do that.
Yeah.
Not a lot of actors want to do it because you can get very claustrophobic. And
sure, because they have to pour all that over you.
Yeah,
and at the time, they're still using like plastic.
You have to do a whole face and body cast.
Oh, a whole body too?
Yeah.
Wow.
With a straw coming out. A lot of people can't cope with that.
Yeah.
They said, are you interested in doing that? I was like, yeah, I'd love to do that.
You know? Why not?
So I did a prosthetics test for it.
Okay.
And then further on down the line, Newt came up in the same kind of way, and I said, I'm not going to just be doing these. How about you employ me to do the voices too?
See, now there, that's the way you do it.
Yeah,
because you were the voice of both characters.
Both characters.
Newt and Keanu.
So Robin was just like, you're really pushing it out here, Silas. You know, do you have like a voice CD? And I was like, yeah, sure. So I gave her one. And so it just kind of, it came out of just getting to know them, working with them,
putting it all together. And two polar opposite characters, so you had to come up with different thoughts for voices too. Now, how soon did you come up with the voices on them?
Well, the voice for Newt is something that George was kind of working on. He wanted like an Eastern Asian sort of voice.
Right.
We listened to lots of different things. And then I threw in the idea of a Sydney Greenstreet kind of character.
Yeah.
You know, you just come up with things, But with Keanu, I just figured, you know, he's a Jedi and he looks and sounds like, or he should look and sound like one of those old, you know, English theatrical actors.
Yeah,
he also
was so
did
cool.
that voice that's rather like Obi-Wan's as well.
Yeah, he was
He's got that sort of, you know, very wise old English. I was thinking about, you know,
it's awesome, right? It's so fun to hear. Because he was, yes, let's, come on! Love that, because he was very calm, but it was perfect for that Jedi, for that character.
Yeah.
He was obviously very wise because he had a very big brain.
Very big brain. Very big brain.
And how many hours then a day were you spent? You
well,
didn't do both of them at the same, like in the same day, ever, would you?
No. Because Obi-Wan was about Obi-Wan.
Now look at that. I've used the Jedi mind.
Ki-Adi Mundi was about 4.5 hours of makeup.
Wow.
It's a very, very thin prosthetic that your skin can breathe through. So once it's glued onto your face, it moves with your face and, you know, your skin is infected. So they build it up slowly bit by bit. and then they paint around it. So they paint around the lips and you know.
Well, the crazy
some pictures of it.
Yeah, the crazy thing about Keanu Wendy is you look nothing alike. Like, there's, you can't find Silas in there, you know what
no.
I mean? Like, you could fool anybody
yeah.
that knows you well walking up.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
This is such a
this
great
is
character.
Such a long time ago we did this. It's lovely to see
in
this.
A galaxy far, far away. Yes,
yeah.
It is. Look at that.
Galaxy
isn't that
far,
great?
Far away.
So, you know, now one of the other cool things is you actually play a third character in the film. Now, but you're not in makeup for this character.
Yeah.
We saw him briefly
yeah,
there.
Yeah, very brief. I mean,
and
it's
we,
like, bang,
well,
he's in and out.
The thing that's cool about this is you kill yourself,
yes.
essentially.
Yes.
You're
I talk to myself and I kill myself.
Yeah, we have that scene. Let's take a look at the, you in action with you, talking to yourself. Wait a second.
It's a Star Wars.
We should not have us.
Double take. We're doomed.
Captain.
Yes, sir.
Tell them we wish to board at once.
With all due respect, the ambassadors for the Supreme Chancellor wish to board immediately.
Yes, of course. As you know, our blockade is perfectly legal, and we'd be happy to receive the ambassadors.
What? What did you say?
The ambassadors are Jedi Knights, I believe.
I knew it. They're here to force a settlement.
Distract them. I will contact Lord Sabus.
Begin landing ground troops.
My lord, is that legal?
I will make it legal.
And the Jedi?
The Chancellor should never have brought them into this. Kill them immediately.
Yes, yes, my lord. As you wish.
You did it to yourself. The short.
I noticed in that how long Newt Gunray's finger is.
Yeah.
Incredibly long. Because he never wears it down, picking his nose.
Oh, no.
Down, so,
yeah.
You
know, oh, he never wears it down. Okay. So that's how this show's going to go. Lieutenant Antidar Williams had a short-lived career there in the Rebellion, but
yeah.
a lot of fun. So now, totally different days as well then, those two scenes, right? Because you're on the screen and, but so.
Yeah, Lieutenant Williams was like one of the first days of filming.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah,
okay.
Absolutely, yeah.
And was that one of those things where it's like, well, you fit into the costume and go for it, or was So, Newt Gunray, bad dude. He's kind of a bad dude. He's a politician. He's a little slimy.
Yeah, he's slimy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Was that fun to play?
Yeah, great. I love playing baddies.
you play, we were talking about this at breakfast, you play either doctors or bad guys.
Yeah, it's really weird. I do a lot of television work in England back home. And I'm forever in hospital dramas playing very benign doctors. You know, really, really lovely, sweet guys who look after their patients very well, good bedside manner.
Yeah.
Or I play a lot of terrorists.
Just bad guys.
You know, like really bad guys, really good guys. And there's nothing ever in between.
No in between. Well, you can play that
it's
in between
weird.
Here today. It is weird. But I am fascinated by the makeup process and the whole thing of becoming these characters, because you really embody these characters vocally, but also physically, because you don't get to then give them any of this. All that you get to do normally as an actor. Is that difficult?
I mean, you know, the thing about doing something like, I'm always intrigued and interested and curious about doing stuff I've not done before.
Sure.
So, you know, when I was talking earlier about the character of Keanu, they said, have you ever worked with prosthetics? And I was like, no, I'd really love to do that.
Right.
I mean, I remember watching The Elephant Man with John Hurt all those years ago, you know. John Hurt was in makeup for 12 and a half hours.
Yes.
To do that each day, 12 and a half hours, because it's very early days of prosthetics work. And I thought, well, what must that be like? What would it be like? It's rather like you doing your voice stuff, you know. It's a completely different discipline.
Yeah.
And the thing about having a big fat mask on, as I do with Newt Gunray, or having prosthetics on, as I do with Keanu Mundi, is that you still have to get that character across. This stuff that you're wearing is very stiff.
Yeah.
And so somehow there has to be a physicalization. Obviously, later on you can do a lot of characterization with the voice.
Right.
But there's got to be a physicalization to it. So, you know, Kiadi is somebody who sits very, very still until he's fighting. There's very little movement in him. And then with Newt, there's all of that kind of hand-wringing.
Yeah.
And, you know, there's a physicalization. You have to push past all of that makeup.
Well, we have a fantastic behind-the-scenes look at you becoming these the various characters. So watch the screen here. This is fantastic work.
The technology of the prosthetics has changed quite a lot.
On the Phantom Menace, what they had was guys off-camera listening to me speaking the lines inside the head with a microphone and an earpiece, and then they would try and remote control the facial expressions, which were very basic.
The second time round, they actually computerized the movement of the mouth, and then I pre-recorded it, and the mouth moved depending on what I had already kind of recorded.
So the plan has gone as you had promised, my lord.
Whoa.
We have, my lord.
Hands off.
So the lip syncing was already done for us. Now they've even refined all of the kind of mechanics of moving the facial expressions. When you're doing something like I am, which is basically I'm not a face actor, I'm within prosthetics, you translate a lot of the personality of the character with your body.
The plan has gone as you had promised, my lord.
So Newt is this kind of very slimy sort of character who is hunched and disappearing inside of himself. And Kiadi has a kind of grace about him, and his body is much stiller and he's much more elegant. And that's the way in which I try to portray my idea of the character through all of this, you know, mechanical, rubbery stuff that's on the outside.
I have doubts about your ability to keep us safe.
Ladies and gentlemen, Silas Carson, come on!
I was so young back then.
Come on.
So fresh.
You're young, you're wonderful.
No gray hairs.
Oh, come on. So, will you stay with us? Because we have,
of course,
we have another guest here that I think, you know, he really, there's no proper introduction I can really give, because he's such a
legend.
Huge name, a legend in Star Wars, in film, in television. But let's take a look at him in action on the screen. Having the two of you here together.
It's brilliant. Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here.
And the two of you never worked together in the films. I mean, you were on in the same films, but you did not work together. You didn't have any scenes together.
Yeah, I mean, that's often the case with films, especially films on the scale of Star Wars and what have you, that, you know, you're in the same movie, but you never, your paths will never cross over
yeah.
a period of, you know, a year of shooting a film.
But you guys have worked together because of Star Wars and various things. Are you, now, have you interviewed Silas before?
I think, no, I haven't.
No? Okay. Would you like to today?
I mean, you've done a great job just now. I mean, he's a very interesting chap.
He is.
And they always make the best interviews, don't they?
Yeah.
That you can actually talk to and get some decent stories from. It's fascinating.
And now we have you. See,
thank you, James.
No, I'm kidding, because we like to give each other a bad time. You can really dish it out, man.
You've
run me over with a segue. You've hit me in the kneecap with a lightsaber. Yeah, we've had fun. So, no, it is great to have you back. Do you know how many Star Wars weekends you've done?
Well, you know, I came to my first Star Wars weekend in 1997, which I believe was like
97.
The inaugural year for the
yeah.
event. I mean, and back then, the talk show used to take place by Star Tours, where
yes.
the Jedi Training Academy is
yeah.
now, and in the kind of the heat that we can feel out there today, we'd be in the full sunlight doing, you know, a half an hour talk show on a very tiny stage. How the event has come on, look where we are today.
Look at all of this, huh? Thank you, Disney. Thank you, Star Wars.
James, I mean, it's brilliant. thanks to these guys who keep coming to the event year after year, tell their friends and support the event, why it has grown to the scale that it has. So thanks to all of you for coming.
Absolutely. Yeah. Thank you very much. We applaud you.
So, let's talk about me.
Let's talk. See, I told you. It's spicy that way. Now, we are going to talk a lot about how you got the role when we go and see an Ewok's Tale, which is happening here. This is the first one for this year. You're going to be performing your one-man show, An Ewok's Tale. Do you know what time it's at?
It's at 5:15. That's the pre-show. I recommend you come to the whole thing. Come to the pre-show. And 5:15 to 6 o'clock. It's a show that really takes you through my life. And I narrate that, and I involve all sorts of different methods to tell my story. It's really fun and interactive, and you may well learn something as well.
And be involved in it. That's what's so cool about it.
And be involved,
it
yes.
A fun show. So I don't want to pull from that too much, but just a brief thing. You were 11 years old, were you not?
Yeah, I was 11 when I was very fortunate to land a role in one of the biggest films in history. I mean, it was an amazing way to start an acting career. In Return of the Jedi, and I was a big fan of the film, so for me it was just so exciting to be on the set of the film, you know, in front of my on-screen heroes.
Yeah, you know. How far away was it all being shot from where you lived and all? Because it was being shot in London then, right?
So yeah, I mean, I lived about an hour's drive from the studio.
So not too bad.
It's funny, you know, you think this business is very glamorous, don't you? I mean, this is the glamorous part of it, of course.
Yes.
But, you know, back then, I mean, I stayed in a hotel called the Grosvenor House Hotel. It sounds very posh, doesn't it? But trust me, it wasn't. There was ice on the inside of the windows of this hotel. It was a very cold winter, the winter that we shot Return of the Jedi, fortunately, because Ewoks like the cold weather. Yeah. And but this hotel was right next to the studio, so it was walking distance. But it was freezing and very, very grim accommodations. But, you know, I just loved being there and being part of this film.
Absolutely. And then Endor, was Endor also there? Or
well, Endor was in two places.
Two different places.
The Ewok village, as you see it, the huts and the little bridges, etc., were built on a soundstage at Elstree Studios in London. And, you know, it was actually built 20 feet off the ground.
It really was.
Even though it didn't really have to be, it gave a great depth. So when you were filming, you know, an angle across the village, you could see down the fact that this was high. But getting the Ewoks up there was a challenge. Because they use these kind of cherry pickers, right? They would herd about 15 Ewoks into this little caged area, and then it would lift up, and then they'd all be herded off, and you'd have to do this process about, you know, five or six times to get all the Ewoks up there, and then the same thing happening when we got them all down again.
Oh, man. We love Wicket. Isn't he just an awesome character? I was, you know, we're the same age. I was 11, probably seeing this for the first time and going, oh, man, that kid.
Age.
Yeah.
He's such a lot older.
See? That's why I tried to get the first jab in.
No, you have got more hair than I have.
Yeah, I don't know about that.
I wake up every morning, my face has got bigger.
Why does that happen? Nothing with him, though. Look at this guy.
Look at him. He's so suave, isn't he? He's like a kind of an English gent.
Yes, he is. Very charming. So, now, one thing I noticed about Wicket is he does a lot with his tongue. Have you noticed this? Have you seen, have you
ever? He does.
Do we have some, I think we have like a little footage we can play. There's a lot of, was that part of that, was that on purpose when you were doing that character?
Yeah, it's kind of cool.
See, like, okay, yeah, there he goes again, he's sticking out his tongue. There he is, oh, sticking out his tongue. See, now that you see it, you can't look away, and it's there every time. There he is, oh, sticking out his tongue. All right. All right, what do you think, Wicket? And there it is!
A lot of people think that that's a CG effect that's been added for the special editions, like the blinking Ewoks.
Yeah.
But no, that was my actual tongue. The faces were quite inanimate, you know. I mean, these were central characters, but they couldn't blink, they couldn't move their mouths. I mean, it was an incredible kind of artistic decision to make. But the way that I got around this was to get my own tongue through the teeth, and it gave the whole face a little bit of life.
It really did. Yeah, I'm joking around, but it really did give him much more reality in there. And we instantly buy this character. How fun was it and strange was it to be working with Princess Leia, though, for a second?
Oh, it's great. I mean, I was 11 years old.
Yeah.
You know, it was lovely to be looked after by Princess Leia. Yeah. And I say that because, you know, it was very hot in an Ewok costume, a bit like being in this environment here. And and Carrie Fisher used to feel a bit worried about me when I took the head off because I looked a little bit red. And she used to be there with chocolate milk and cookies, saying, "Say, Warwick, are you okay? Can I get it?" And I think I started to ham it up a bit.
Carrie.
She'd be there.
Oh my goodness. I've spent time.
She wouldn't
with
put
her.
The bikini on though, I
no. Yes. I spent time with her at Celebration, and I've been spanked by Carrie and tackled by Carrie.
Really?
In many ways. And yes, every 11-year-old's dream.
You just told us your dream. That didn't really happen.
It did. I think we have pictures, but well, not today. So you are a very busy actor as well, doing other things. Now there is Celebrity Squares.
Yes, you know it as Hollywood Squares, but in the UK we just revived it. I've been doing the second series, it is actually airing at the moment. It's called Celebrity Squares, and I'm the host. I'm a game show host now.
How awesome is that?
It's kind of weird that I'm doing that, but there I am.
Look at that.
Celebrity Squares. And we have some, you know, great celebrities on there, and it's the format that you know and love and created over here in the US. But what's interesting, CBS, they come over and they kind of oversee the whole thing, and I have to use certain language. You have to say, do you agree or disagree? Yes, you were right to agree, you know, cross gets the square. You have to do all of that language to make sure it adheres to the format.
Right, and then you said also something that we don't say, which is series.
So series.
We would say a season.
Season.
You know, series. Yeah. But then the strangest thing is that you actually took an American show, because we're always stealing all of your shows and turning them in. You guys produce some great stuff, and then we end up taking it and messing it up somehow with American shows. It's never as good as the stuff you see on the BBC.
But you did that with the English language as well.
I've just alienated most of the audience. That was a bit of a...
Yeah, here's an Ewok's tale. They'll be on Star Tours at 5:15.
Yeah, there'll be three English people in the audience. That'll be it.
He's marvelous. Isn't he marvelous? So, another thing you've been doing is theater.
Yes.
Back home. So when you left Star Wars Weekends last year, you went home and started doing See How They Run.
Yeah, I toured a play called See How They Run, which is a farce. It's a very particular type of British comedy, very much larger than life. And it's about Vickers' mistaken identity. And it's out of my dream of wanting to do a proper play.
Right.
A play that didn't rely on the fact that I was short. And
are you short?
I am short, yeah.
I'm
shorter than you, Jack.
I don't think so.
Just saying something. Well, they're turning now. You're on your side.
Silas, take over.
I'm watching this with glee.
Properly too.
Okay. So yes, See How They Run, we toured the UK and it was brilliant. I employed a group of other fellow short actors.
Sure.
And I reduced the scale of the set, so when you watch the play, you know, after a couple of minutes you would actually forget that we were indeed short actors and just enjoy the play for its merits and for the performances, hopefully.
We have a trailer of it. Let's take a look at that. That's right. Really great stuff.
Amazing, and he's a feeling
actor. I must speak.
Shut up. It's the end
of the hour. So much fun, and so busy.
Early crying. I really, really enjoyed it.
Ding, gone.
God, help me.
Oh, well, that's nice.
Hey, See How They Run. Are you going to do more shows?
We'd love to do more. Whether we will, I don't know. It's very expensive to put on a play. I financed the whole thing.
Did you really?
It was a lovely thing artistically to do, but financially was quite challenging.
Well, we could pass it up around here and just do another
one. Absolutely, it's still a crowdfunding project, yeah.
Hey, you know, you guys always have fun with me here, and I wanted to have some fun with you. Now, I don't know, are you guys aware of the new Shakespeare Star Wars books? Have you guys seen these? Shakespeare Star Wars? A writer took the story of Star Wars, the first ones, A New Hope, Empire Strikes Back, and Return of the Jedi, and put them in the form of a Shakespearean play.
Wow.
So I thought it would be fun if we did a scene from that. What do you guys think? Yeah? So, okay. So this is from A New Hope. And so it's time for, what should we call it, a masterpiece mashup? Let's run around a little bit there.
Yeah? And now, a Star Wars masterpiece mashup.
Okay. A masterpiece mashup. People love mashups. So I'm giving you your parts. And we can, you know, maybe we can, should we stand for this?
Should we
take the stage? So I will be reading Luke Skywalker, which is fun. That's great for me. Silas, you will be playing Obi-Wan Kenobi, because I get a break from that. And you will be Han Solo.
Oh, yes. He's my favorite.
He is, right?
The one everyone wants to read.
Yes. Okay. So this is the scene in the cantina where we're trying to acquire the Millennium Falcon to take us someplace else, right? And get away from it. So you guys, you're cold reading it. This is what we call cold reading, where they're seeing the script for the first time.
Yes.
And it's all put in this very Shakespearean way. So do you guys think we can handle it? We good? You ready?
Let's give it a shot.
We got the cantina behind us. Excellent. So Han, you take it away. It's the first scene. So we come up to see Han Solo.
Okay. Han Solo at thy service, gentlemen. The great Millennium Falcon is my ship. My first mate Chewie telleth me ye seek safe passage to the system Alderaan.
Aye, true, if 'tis a vessel swift of flight.
A vessel swift of flight, thou sayest. Hast thou not heard of the Millennium Falcon, sir?
Now shall he boast, but if his ship we have, some boasting will endure. Nay, should I have?
Tis but the ship that hath the Kessel Run accomplished in 12 parsecs, nothing more. Imperial starships have the Cillian scout. But nothing more of that.
Slightly escaped.
Did someone escape? Yes. Slightly escaped.
Slightly
nothing more than that. And neither do I speak about bulk cruisers small, but vast, brilliant ships, yet nothing more, no more. I shall not brag about her speed, good sir. Suffice to say, the ship shall fill thy needs. As she is the fastest, but nothing more.
Boy, it went a lot faster in the movie. Nothing more. I wish he'd hold his peace, this man. It seems doth love his ship far more than e'er I saw a man with his woman love. Oh.
Pray tell, what shall the cargo be?
Myself. The boy, two droids, and ne'er a question asked.
Tis what, a touch of local trouble here?
Nay, let us simply say thus. We would imperial entanglements avoid.
Aye, there's the rub. So shalt thou further pay. 10,000 is the cost, and every bit shalt thou deliver ere we leave the dock.
10,000? Fie! We could our own ship buy for such a sum of this.
A jolly jest. For who would pilot such a ship? Shouldst thou?
Thou knave, I could indeed. A pilot skilled am I in my own right. Now should we stay and be abused more by this man's words?
2,000 can we render to thee now, and 15 more deliver when we come with safety unto Alderaan's bright port.
Say 17? Congratulations, man, thou hast the ship secured, and will depart whene'er thou art prepared. Thou shalt find me at docking harbor number 94.
Aye. 94.
94 and
scene!
Wow. That took a while.
That was a challenge. It took a while.
I mean that in a good way. It was good. You guys had fun? Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, excellent. So, we are going to be seeing an Ewok's tale soon. We're going to see you back here tomorrow, right?
Absolutely.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's Silas Carson, it's Warwick Davis. Let's do a selfie, guys.
Thank you.